I thank the organizers of this distinguished conference. I am glad to be here among you. I have first essay on my paper title, Longest Century of Empire belongs to an eminent Turkish historian. He used this depiction as a metaphor in order to tell the long-lasting weak position of Ottoman Empire. Actually, along 19th century, the Ottoman sultans tried to recover from bad situation which empire struggling for. 19th century was a reform age for Ottoman Empire. Actually, the roots of this reform go back to the previous century. An attempt started from end of 18th century by the hand of Sultan Selim III, but he dethroned from the Sultanate and killed 187. After him, Mahmud II took his position as Sultan, but his reign between 187-1839 was one of the most crisis periods of the Ottoman state. Kavalalı Mehmet Ali Paşa, who was a government of him in Egypt, started to act as a separate manner and defeated Sultan's army one after another. The pressure of the Russian Tsarism on the Ottoman state was increasing day by day. After the French Revolution, the ideas of nationalism had an effect on the non-Muslim subjects of the empire. Greece, Bulgaria, Serbia were separated from the empire. The Austrian Empire had occupied the Bosnia-Herzegovina. The Balkans were boiling. In 1854, together with European allies, Turkey entered the Crimean War against Russia. The war had several financial consequences. The Ottoman state was heavily indebted to European creditors. European creditors confiscated the tax of the six main income sources of the Ottoman state in order to collect their money until they would fully obtain their receivables. These are the taxes from the salt, revenue stamp, silk, tobacco, alcoholic beverage, and fish industries. That's why the 19th century was the longest for the Ottoman Empire. At the beginning of this century, in 1808, local feudal lords attempted to make a space for themselves by limiting the Sultan's powers. They signed a convention with the Sultan for this aim. Then in the 1839, the Sultan issued a firman saying that the all Ottoman citizens, both Muslim or non-Muslims, are equal and have the same rights. All Ottoman citizens have security of life, property, and honor. No one can be openly or secretly executed, poisoned, or property confiscated without public trial. No one can be punished for the crime of another. Conscription will be for a certain period of time. Taxes will be levied according to the everyone's ability. Since the Ottoman state wanted to get the support of the European states, it also informed the foreign ambassadors in Istanbul of this edict. Actually, the practice of political murder was abolished by a law in 1838 before Tanzimat. Now the Tanzimat firman emphasized this once again in 1839. From now on, the political death penalty could only be given in limited cases and only by a court decision. In 1856, once again, the Ottoman Sultan felt the need to emphasize the rights provided to non-Muslim citizens by issuing another edict called Reform Edict. A question may arise here. Didn't the Ottoman state give these basic rights to its citizens before? But it was true that civil servants did not have these rights, but people have. Because the civil servants were the servants of Sultan, and whenever the Sultan thought it necessary, he could confiscate their property and take their lives. This situation resulted in the victimization of the age of the punished person, as stated in the Tanzimat Edict. Thus, since 1839, when the Tanzimat Edict was announced, civil servants in Turkey were given full job security and basic rights. The two edicts that we have just mentioned this century brought important developments in terms of the legal status of non-Muslims. Previously, non-Muslims who would be said to have the same rights as Muslims in terms of basic rights had little role in the state bureaucracy. A few people were employed in some jobs, such as interpreting affairs, for example. When the Ottoman Parliament was opened in 1876, Muslim parliamentarians as well as non-Muslims took their places, reflecting the population ratios of the empire. Neither Russia nor any other country had parliamentarians of any other religion or ethnicity to this extent. The first constitution was adopted along with the parliament in 1876. Although it has suspended for a long time, it came into force again in 1908. This constitution had almost the same features as its contemporary examples in Europe. It's originated from the Belgian constitution. We are talking about a transformation in the legal system. We can now move on the other aspects of this transformation. After the 1870s, new European-style schools were opened in the field of legal education, and today's Istanbul Law Faculty, of which I am a member, is based on this attempt. In this century, for the first time, the Ottoman state gets a judicial organization from France in order to establish a tripartite court structure. In 1868, courts of appeal were established both in the field of law and penal law and in the field of administrative jurisdiction. The Supreme Court in the administrative judiciary was conceived according to the French Conseil d'État. The traditional cadre courts also existed. In this case, the separate courts operating in a new way and an old way coexisted. This means duality in the judicial organization. We will see this duality in the applicable laws as well. Religious law on the one hand and laws taken from France on the other would begin to coexist. This situation was a characteristic feature seen all institutions in the Ottoman state in this century. Prosecutor's office, advocacy, and notary public were included in the court system in the last quarter of this century. Ottoman Kadı was doing the works that the notary public had done before. It was common for a husband or father or a third person to represent in court for his wife or daughter or for some time for someone else, but it was not a profession. Now those with certain skills would be able to practice law as a profession. Thus, in 1876, the Istanbul Bar Association was established. This century, there was a great legislative activity in the Ottoman state. Legislation also developed in two areas. Tanzimat, which gave its name to the second half of the century, meant enactment new laws. One of these two areas was the making of laws of local character. First was local character. The Land Code of 1858 was expressing the first compact Ottoman land regime, followed by the movement to codify Islamic law by the state for the first time in history. Between 1876 and 1869 and 1876, a committee of scholars led by Ahmet Cevdet Paşa made the Ottoman Civil Code, called Mecelle, depends on religious law. Honestly, it wasn't exactly a civil code. There was only the law of property and law of obligation sections. It also enacted the law of trial, taking into account the needs of the period. I can say that the law of persons was also immanent, but there were no general provisions of civil law. It did not regulate family law and inheritance law either. But this was a brand new thing in the history of Islamic law. The state put the Islamic law in a court first time. After that, the state could interfere with it to a certain extent. However, until this date, the field of civil law was left to the ulama, independent scholars. It was now again in their domain, but to a certain extent, the state played a regulatory selective role on it. Now, let's leave the Islamic codes aside and look at the transfer of European laws to Turkey. In 1850, the French commercial code was adopted. Interest was strictly forbidden in Islamic law, but this law accepted that anyone who did not pay his debt on the time had to pay interest due to delay with this court. This was a clear violation of Islamic law, but it was allowed because of, in Turkish, zaruret means necessity and common need. Necessity as a term of Islamic law means to be able to do things to a limited extent that you cannot do in normal times. Criminal code in 1858, commercial procedure law in 1861, maritime trade law in 63, criminal procedure law in 79, and again this year, the law on civil procedure was adopted through adaptation from French laws. Let's say about slaves here a bit, Ottoman legal system. The slave market in Istanbul was closed in 1847 by order of Sultan Abdülmecid. On this date, orders were sent to the governors of Egypt, Tripoli, and Baghdad, and it was stated that the slave trade was strictly prohibited, and those who did not obey the order would be punished. In 1890, the Ottoman Empire accepted the Brussels Convention, which banned the trade of black captives. 1819, the sale of Circassian and other slaves and concubines was also prohibited. Despite the prohibition of captivity, the state did not accept a local judge to put a slave up for auction and dismissed the judge from his job. Meanwhile, new interpretations have begun to appear on how to understand the punishment of Islamic law. The penalty had cut for theft is based on custom. The penalty cannot be applied today because the custom has changed, say the prominent scholar. This is really against the Islamic law, actually. But now a scholar thinks like that and write down this. However, in practice, the slave trade continued to a greater or lesser extent. But many things have changed now. In a trial on May 10, 1910, the slave in the estate refused to obey the deceased children. He demanded the necessary action by stating that according to the Constitution, everyone was free, that the population administrations deleted the slave records, and that everyone was free under the Constitutional administration. Thus, I think I could give you a concise idea about the transformations in the legal system in the Ottoman state in the 19th century. Thank you for your attention.